Hey folks, it's Ray at DCRainmaker.com here, and I've got 23 things to know about the new DJI FPV drone. Now, this video is not sponsored by DJI or anyone else. I'm going to tell you the good, the bad, and the ugly about the new DJI FPV system. You can go ahead and use the YouTube chapters optional on the bottom there of the video to skip around to the chapters and chunks that you want to know more about. Now, before we get into all those new things, a very short 10-second primer on the difference between an FPV drone and a regular drone. Now, FPV stands for first-person view, which means that you're controlling the aircraft with the goggles there as opposed to a screen on your controller. Beyond that, the differences mostly have to do with the aircraft itself, and it really comes down to maneuverability and agility. An FPV drone tends to be way more maneuverable and can go upside down and usually turn much faster and sharper and do all sorts of more interesting aerobatic type maneuvers than a regular drone can. Inversely though, it's also much harder to fly, typically kind of like learning a different language. Now, historically, you're probably thinking of FPV drones more like the racing realm, but that's really not what DJI is going for. This one is way too heavy for that sort of thing. Instead, they're targeting more of the cinematic FPV market, which is what's pretty much like proliferated YouTube over the last year or two. And it's really what I'm gonna focus the majority of this review on, as opposed to sort of the acrobatic flying. Now, the kit comes with three core parts. You've got the drone itself, you've got the goggles, and then you have the controller. The motion controller is not part of the stock kit, that's extra. Within the kit though, you do have the drone battery there, as well as the goggle battery. And that's the first item on our new things list is probably the craziest one that you're gonna see when you witness in real life, which is the new emergency brake and hover option. What this means is that you're flying along at full speed and you can one tap a button on the controller to go and stop the drone virtually instantly, within like a couple meters. Here, look at this video right here. I'm going 100 kilometers an hour and I hit that button and it stops at just a handful of meters, not very far at all. And it hovers there by itself. Now, the real goal for this feature is actually you better go ahead and just simply get yourself out of a sticky situation. So you can see here, I put the aircraft into a bit of a spin. I just simply tap that button and boom, it's leveled back out again. And anytime you use that emergency brake, it puts it back in a normal mode and not the manual FPV mode. And we'll talk about that in just a sec. The idea here being that you can take a breather, mentally reset without having to pick up all the pieces of the aircraft on the ground. And that sort of feature is pretty important when you consider the top speeds of the FPV system. So the very top speed is 140 kilometers an hour or 87 miles per hour in full manual mode. Then from there, you drop down to sport mode with a wee 97 kilometers an hour or 60 miles per hour. And then below that, there is normal mode, which is 50 kilometers an hour or 31 miles per hour. Within that, it can accelerate to 100 kilometers an hour in 2 seconds flat. Oh, hey, and a quick note, if you're finding this video useful or interesting, simply whack that like button at the bottom there. It really helps out this video and the channel quite a bit. Now, as I just mentioned, there are three modes to this drone. You've got your normal mode, which is similar to what you'd have on a DJI Mavic Air 2 or something like that. You've got your sport mode, which is also most of the DJI drones. It increases the speed, it allows more angle during the turns. And then you have manual mode. And manual mode on the FPV system is the full FPV mode. You can toggle between these three modes using the little switch on the back right there, very simple. However, out of the box, the manual mode is actually not enabled. So even when you go into manual mode like this, it won't actually enable it. Instead, you have to go into the goggles, into the menu system and enable it there. But even more than that, every time you toggle to manual mode on the controller, you have to do this little controller quiz, if you will, to go ahead and confirm that you actually mean to be in manual mode. It's a bit of a safety check against accidentally hitting that button and instantly crashing your drone. However, within the manual mode, there are actually two FPV modes. The first mode is the default, which is the attitude mode enabled, which means you can't flip over your drone. So it's like a protection scheme again to keep you from killing your drone in the very first flight. You can then disable that, and that allows you to invert your drone and do flips and rolls and whatever else you want. No matter which mode you have though, you always have auto land and auto takeoff, which means you can go ahead and use the automatic buttons on the controller itself to get the aircraft up into the air, as well as to land the aircraft. And in FPV drones, landing an aircraft can often be the most complicated thing. So this is just another step DJI has taken to keep you from killing your drone on the very first flight. And as part of auto land is return to home or RTH, and that'll fly the drone back to the same exact point it took off at. Keep in mind though, that while it has obstacle avoidance sensors, it will not avoid obstacles in the RTH mode, but you can go hit the stop button anytime you want if you're watching the goggles and it's about to hit a tree or whatever the case may be. The next new feature is cruise control. And this is something they just recently introduced to the Mavic Air 2, and it's pretty sweet for FPV in particular. What it allows you to do is as you're flying along, you can go ahead and hit this button to start and stop, and it maintains that exact speed the entire time, no matter what else you're doing from a flying standpoint. I found this super useful when I'm trying to repeat the same maneuver over and over again, especially high speed passes where I really want to maintain that high speed and focus purely on flying the aircraft as opposed to dealing with the throttle side of things. So you can see that here in this passage under the bridge there, where it controls things at 100 kilometers an hour underneath this bridge, and I can just focus on flying. Though sometimes I probably should have focused just a wee bit more, because this one attempt right here, I actually clipped the bridge. Listen to this. The kicker is I didn't even notice that it clipped the bridge until later on when I looked at the footage and heard the ting in the audio recordings from both the drone as well as the FPV goggles. Okay, so let's talk about some of that camera jazz right now. So 4K at up to 60 frames per second or 1080p at up to 120 frames per second. You can control this from within the goggles. You can also go ahead and set either H.264, H.265, as well as having a decent-like mode too for going ahead and doing the color correction afterwards. Now it's worthy to note, this camera and the gimbal are designed to be flown at speed. So if you're flying level, just hovering there, you'll see the props in the camera view. Once you tilt forward and give it some speed, then the props drop out of view. On the photo side though, it's just JPEG photos and only 8-megapixel photos. It's just using the same 4K image crop. The real key though is the stabilization aspects of it. So this one here has a single axis gimbal. Compared to most other DJI drones that have three axis gimbals, this only goes up and down. You can see that it's like this there. Instead, what they use is DJI's Osmo Action Stabilization. So this is their action camera right here. They basically stuff this inside of that. Now in the drone, they call it EIS, or Electronic Image Stabilization, versus on the action camera, they call it Rocksteady. Same concept though. You can turn this on and off if you want to. Here's a quick side-by-side showing on and off in case you did want to turn it off and stabilize outside of the drone itself later on. Still, I found the stabilization very, very good here. One minor note though is that the feed that's sent to your goggles, that's recorded on your goggles on the SD card there, is not image stabilized. So they just send that across at low latency as opposed to applying any image stabilization to it. The next little feature I'm loving is auto record on takeoff. This is really simple. The second the aircraft goes in the air, it starts recording, and the second it lands, it stops recording. You can choose to record just the drone footage or the drone and the goggles SD card as well as a backup, which is what I choose by default. But this is the first time we've seen it on a DJI drone, despite being out in the market on other companies' drones for quite a while. Now, the next thing to note is the sensors. So on the FPV drone, there are two forward sensors, and then there are two downwards facing imaging sensors, plus two depth of field sensors. However, these sensors will not stop the aircraft from running into something. Instead, they give you warnings. So as you're flying along in the goggles, you'll first see a yellow warning when you're approaching something, and then a red warning when it thinks something is dangerous. However, I found that the system is pretty wimpy. Like it's way wimpier than I am, which is saying something because I'm a little bit wimpy when it comes to this kind of stuff. I pretty much had to ignore it most of the time. And what's a little bit more disappointing about the obstacle avoidance here is that there is no option to toggle to simply stop when you get to red, like there is on the rest of DJI's product suite. And if their goal is to be able to bridge those two worlds of FPV and non-FPV, for beginners, this would seem like something that would be logical to at least have as an option to enable to, again, keep you from killing your really expensive drone. Speaking of things that are not in this drone, it's any of DJI's intelligent flight modes or any special modes whatsoever. There is nothing like active track or hyperlapse or waypoints or tripod or anything like that. Anything that tracks things or follows things or does automated moves, orbiting around something, doesn't exist here at all. So if you value those things, you're still going to need to take another drone with you or just fly manual. And I think that's a bit of a lost opportunity because those are some of DJI's strongest assets. And hopefully we'll see them incorporated into this drone or maybe a future drone down the road so that if people are traveling, they can go and take just one drone as opposed to having to take two drones. Because I think a lot of people still find value in all those things from tracking to automated shots and whatnot that they may want to get to fill in the rest of their entire sequence. Now, despite not having special modes, it does have DJI's AirSense. This is something introduced a year or two ago, and it allows you to go ahead and see air traffic around you, like real world planes around you. So as a plane approaches, you'll see on the goggles a warning first that there's a plane in the general vicinity. I think it's like a couple kilometers out. And then once it gets really close to you, it'll go ahead and give you a red warning as well that the aircraft is even closer. Now keep in mind though, this is only the lateral distance and not the vertical distance. So even when I was sitting there thousands of feet below aircraft that were passing way above me, more than a dozen miles from the airport, it was triggering those aircraft. Next, let's briefly talk about the goggles. This is the DJI FPV version 2 goggles. These came out a couple months ago, so by themselves, they aren't very new. They have two latency levels within them. The first is 120 frames per second at 28 milliseconds, and they have a lower latency, higher quality option at 60 frames per second at 40 milliseconds. And in my testing, in all of my scenarios, I never lost connectivity. Now, I wasn't trying to fly like 5 kilometers away because that's against the rules here. Of course, every environment will be different depending on what's going on out there, so I wouldn't necessarily convert my area to your area. You're just gonna have to kind of see for yourself. The transmission system between all this stuff is using Ocusync 3.0, which is the first time DJI has used that platform in their drones. They've also renamed it now to O3 because it sounds cooler. I don't know why. They just did. So it's called O3. It's got stronger anti-interference tech, and it's got more antennas inside of it, and it's reduced latency. Now, if you do lose connection, it's not a huge deal. There's three options. You can do a return to home, a hover, or a land. By default, it'll go ahead and hover, and it'll also hover into normal mode and not manual mode. Also notable that if you hit your safety limits that you defined, for example, for distance and altitude, it'll toggle into normal mode, so taking you out of manual or sport mode. On the flip side, this is the new DJI FPV remote here. It's quite different than the original FPV remote. Obviously, it's much, much smaller. It's got an entire antenna bar up here, like this T-bar, if you will, at the top. But what you won't notice is any sort of phone holder on this, which will sound obvious to FPV people, but not so obvious to non-FPV people. You solely use the goggles to control the drone. That's it. I think that's also a bit of a lost opportunity though, because there are many scenarios where for legal reasons, you may not have a spotter nearby and just need to get some quick shots and you don't necessarily need the goggles. To be able to put a phone on this and just use it in a conventional setting would make a lot more sense. You will be able to connect a phone to this using the app, but then you don't have like a place to put it. It's a little bit awkward. On the flip side, literally, by the way, you can open up these flaps right here and adjust the controller sensitivity. The idea being that you can go ahead and remove the tension so it acts like a normal FPV controller. Next, we got the new motion controller. That's this little joystick looking thing right here. It costs an extra $200. That's not included in the kit itself. And the idea is that you use the motion, as the name implies, to control the drone. So you can see me rotating left and right there. And if I tilt it up and down, it tilts it up and down. And as I press this throttle button in the bottom there, it goes in and controls the drone's throttle and sends me flying forward. Now, in my testing, I was pleasantly surprised. I expected this to be like a giant dumpster fire. And it wasn't. And I keep in mind, I come from the realm of like a decade's worth of drone flying, some real world flying, all that kind of stuff. And I expect this to be like a toy, and it wasn't bad, at least in normal mode. I have not been able to try sport mode or manual mode because they're not enabling the firmware up until today. Hopefully by the time this video launches, it'll be enabled, but it's not yet there today. And that to me is probably the biggest opportunity here is to be able to use this to control the drone as opposed to the joysticks for people that may not have familiarity with typical FPV joystick control. Next, a quickie, the goggles do have audience mode just like the previous goggles do. This allows you to have multiple people with goggles link up to this goggle to see what you're seeing. You can also then pipe it out from the goggles to a phone as well if you want to go ahead and just see it on the phone or tablet or something like that. In addition, like before, you can record OSD data as well, which is what you're seeing right now on the screen, so you can look at speed and latency and all that kind of stuff later on if you want to. The one thing there isn't, at least as of this very moment I'm filming the video, is the ability to go ahead and record the entire screen, including the menu overlays and stuff. I'd really appreciate that. I think other people would find it valuable as well for teaching on YouTube how to fly FPV, but I see everything on the screen, exactly what I'm seeing from a goggle perspective. Next, DJI has released a new simulator that allows you to fly this aircraft virtually before you go and crash it and kill it outside. The idea being that you could even buy the goggles if you wanted to and the controller ahead of time, practice a bunch, dozens of hours, and then go outside and fly it without hopefully killing it on your first flight. Next, a quickie here, which is swappable canopy covers. This goes and swaps out the clear one right there, giving it this beautiful chroma key green color, I guess. Look, it's easier to see from far away, but something like this is obviously cheap plastic, which is fine. It does mean though that we'll probably see tons of cool third-party options out on the interwebs once they get a hold of this mold to do something super creative on your drone itself. So that brings us to swapping of parts and fixability. And that's probably the core concern of most people here is how fixable is this drone? And DJI says the answer is, mostly fixable. Now, tossed on the screen right now an incomplete parts and price list. There are some parts that will be coming but are not yet available pricing-wise, an example being the motors. But so you can see on the list there, things like the arm spars and the gimbal and the shell and all that kind of stuff is available, albeit DJI-type prices. Now, in line with fixability is finding your drone when you crash it. And DJI has got kind of a two-parter here. As part of, quote, Find My Drone, within the goggles itself, you can go into Find My Drone and it'll replay the last 30 seconds of footage. And you can pause and play as many times as you want to go ahead and find the exact moment that it crashed and where it crashed, which is useful. And then if you have your phone linked up to the goggles, you can see an exact map of the last known point of location itself. Next, we have battery life. Now, the specs here are on the screen right there, and I'd say that I'm seeing a little bit less than that, and that's probably because it's winter here, because I'm flying a heck of a lot faster. They're claiming 40 kilometers an hour. I'm doing like 60 to 100 kilometers an hour most of the time. So I'm seeing like 12-ish minutes, give or take, and I'm depleting the battery down to 5 to 8%. On the goggles, goggle battery, I'm also seeing it lower than spec as well. I'm seeing like 6 to 8 flights worth versus 110 minutes, what they're saying, which would be more than that at their 20 minute specs. So point being that it's still lower, but it's also winter here. So that's probably impacting things as well there. And then for the controller, it's spec'd at 9 hours, which is like way more than I'd ever really need. Now for the last item, before we get into my final thoughts, I'd be remiss if I did not discuss the startup sound, because it's just special. Here, let me just go ahead and turn this on here. There we go, 1, 2, 3, and give it a quick listen. That is a sound of death. That's the same sound your drone will make when it hits a concrete pillar at 140 kilometers an hour, roughly. So I appreciate that they remind you that every single time you start up your drone. Now, bigger question here though is whether or not it's worth buying this or another drone. And frankly, that's gonna depend 100% on what you plan to do with it. If you're coming from the traditional FPV world, you're probably looking at this with two thoughts. Damn, and damn that price. And those are both 100% true. And I think if you have no FPV experience, this is probably a complete overkill, poor choice to start off with. And the reason is simple. You're gonna probably kill it really quickly and it's gonna cost you a lot of money. You should start off with small toy FPV drones and work your way up, things that cost, you know, a couple hundred bucks at most. And then once you got all that figured out, then jump over to this, which still has a ton of safety features to keep you from ideally killing it as long as you understand the baseline stuff. If you're coming from the rest of the DJI world where you have all these advanced flight modes and stuff like that, again, none of that's here. So you gotta kind of keep those compromises in mind as you jump over to this. Now, if you're experienced in FPV and doing a lot of cinematic FPV, then you're probably gonna find a ton of value in a stabilization in some of those aspects here, including the battery life, that you wouldn't necessarily find in a normal FPV drone out there. Undoubtedly though, this is DJI's first FPV product. And while it's an impressive lot of things, I suspect if we fast forward even 6 months or a year from now, the firmware will look dramatically different. And if we fast forward another year or two from now, the actual hardware and what they do with it and all the capabilities will also look dramatically different. But it's super cool to see what they've done capability-wise with the first-gen product. With that, hope you found this video interesting. If so, whack that like button bottom there or hit subscribe for plenty more sports technology goodness. With that, have a good one.